Environmental justice in South Africa, next on Enviro Close Up. Welcome to Enviro Close Up. I'm Carl Grossman. With me is Hitan Kalan, and he is the head of the South African Exchange Program on Environmental Justice. Now, Hitan, you are from South Africa.
Yes, I am.
But educated here in the United States in terms of college.
That's right.
And you're sticking here in the U.S. trying to do something about environmental injustice, environmental inequity in South Africa. Now, we've heard, we've seen for decades now about the atrocious human rights situation in South Africa. What you've been saying for a number of years, and you're continuing to say, is that the environmental justice picture has not been much better, and in fact needs a great deal of work today. Can you elaborate?
Exactly. I've always argued and actually proposed that the apartheid system has been as violent on the environment as it has been on its people. The issue of human rights has always been at the forefront, and rightfully so. Unfortunately, we did not have the issue of environment up front with all the other issues. And what we find now that we have a new government in South Africa, the first democratically elected government, led by the African National Congress, that we're going to have to deal with all these issues of housing, education, welfare, and the environment. And what has apartheid done to the environment in the last 350 years has been absolutely atrocious. And that is what we need to focus on, because otherwise what we're going to find is that we've inherited a toxic dump, we've inherited a land that's just been degraded. And how are we going to reverse that?
Let me read from some literature, very, very moving literature from the South African Exchange Program on Environmental Justice. The importation of hazardous waste, the dumping of mercury in rivers, the strip mining of coal and uranium, the outdated methods of producing synthetic fuel, along with the rampant poverty, lack of sewage facilities, and deliberate structuring of the notorious homelands present South Africa with serious environmental concerns. Absolutely. I don't think most U.S. citizens are aware about the environmental mess in South Africa. Apparently one of the principal activities of your group is to go educate people.
Exactly.
How do you do it? Where do you go?
Well, we do a number of things. One of them is we try to write articles in popular magazines or journals to highlight how apartheid has impacted the environment. I go and speak to various organizations, universities, campuses, as often as I possibly can, what used to be anti-apartheid groups. And so we try to do as much of that as we possibly can so that people can say, this is a new angle on South Africa that I've never really looked at before. And it's an angle that I can connect with an issue here. And I think that's what drives a lot of people. Because I speak to environmentalists who are doing work in this country, who now begin to see the international ramifications of their work and what are the international ties. I speak to anti-apartheid folks, and they are now presented with a new angle to address post-apartheid South Africa. But most often what I get is the response is, apartheid and environment, what are you talking about? You know, what's the connection? And the connection is very clear. Apartheid had deliberately put 87% of people on 13% of the land. I mean, right there off the back, we're talking of an environmental problem. And no one can then argue against that. And then you start getting into everything else, the mining, the fact that South Africa did for some extent enjoy first world status among the white community, and the black community, the third world status, offers us this microcosm of the globe. We have your traditional first world environmental problems coupled with your traditional third world problems. And so there's this amazing maze of environmental problems that we need to start looking at that were a direct impact, that were directly relevant to apartheid. And that's the main link. And what I found is that most people that I spoke to, after you sort of spend some time breaking the different components down, begin to see South and Southern Africa in a new light and become very interested and involved.
Now, in this country, when we talk about environmental equity, environmental justice, what you talk about is people of color mm-hmm. ending up getting dumped on, where the big toxic waste dumps and toxic waste facilities are located in the U.S. Largely, our areas were African Americans, and Latino Americans, and Native Americans in the Pacific Islands. Also, Asian Americans reside. The same thing in Africa, in South Africa, in terms of people of color?
Exactly the same thing. Apartheid policies were racist to begin with. So they would dump, recklessly dump, in communities, black communities, build the industries upwind from communities, because there's a double effect here. Not only is the environmental burden on the black community, but what has happened is that these black communities also served as a cheap source of labor in these industries. So not only were they exploiting labor, they were exploiting the environment at the same time. So, and apartheid policies created incentives for corporations to set up shop close to black townships and in parts of the homelands.
And in this country, in the United States, the result of environmental inequity, environmental injustice, the siting of these noxious, toxic
right.
facilities and dumps in communities of color has been cancer epidemic right. in these communities of color. I mean, a very clear relationship, and that's been established by the Commission for Racial Justice, and even now the U.S. government is finally the EPA acknowledging the situation. In South Africa, is it the same equation? Do people of color in South Africa, as a result of the siting of environmentally toxic facilities and sites, are they suffering in terms of their health?
They're suffering immensely, but the problem is, let's go a step back, there's never been any major regulations around siting of hazardous and toxic waste. The regulations may have existed, but they weren't always enforced. So we find a lot of illegal dumping taking place. Dumping that's taken place that we still don't know about and probably won't know about until we start collecting a national database on people's health and try to figure out why is it that this particular spot has a higher cancer rate? Or why are these children suffering from asthma more than a community 100 miles from them? So companies were illegally dumping toxic waste in massive amounts, which we still won't have any ideas about because everything was clouded under the guise of secrecy. Under apartheid.
And the situation as you describe it in your literature, and I suggest viewers write to your organization and get some of this very important stuff, the situation as you describe it is not in the past tense. In fact, as the push really is on now post-apartheid in South Africa to industrialize exactly. all of South Africa, if anything, some of this environmental injustice, this environmental inequity, is increasing. I mean, wow.
It is phenomenal once you see some of the sites in South Africa. It's actually mind-boggling to think that people live in these areas, surrounded by oil refineries, airports, two industrial sites, paper processing plants. I'm talking of one community.
Which
community of Mierbank. Just north of Durban in Natal, the province of Natal, is a community of immediately impacting 40,000, but really impacting about 200,000 Indians, coloreds, and whites. And there's two massive industrial plants, the airport, all these different other industries that I mentioned earlier, surrounding this community. And there was a health impact done on this community. Children had incredibly high rates of respiratory problems. Everyone who I met had respiratory problems because of the oil refineries. The only side where they don't really have an industry is the ocean. But what's happening to that ocean is that all these industries have their little canals that flow right into the ocean. So people who fish for their livelihood are fishing in waters that have already been contaminated.
We'll be back with Enviro Close-Up right after this.
Since 1974, Plenty International has been a valuable tool for people who want to lend a hand, but in ways that are effective, respectful, and appropriate. Much needs to be done, like installing running water for Mayan villages in the highlands of Guatemala, helping Native Americans develop home gardens, and working for the improved nutrition of children in Nicaragua. Plenty fields volunteers from all walks of life and recognizes the interdependence of all living things and works to promote economic fair play, cultural diversity, and a livable environment. If we put our minds, hearts, and hands together, we can do what needs to be done. For more information, please write Plenty, P.O. Box 2306, Davis, California, 95617, or call 916-753-0731.
The dump site we're proposing is perfectly safe, trust me.
The people who tell you that nuclear waste dumps are safe are stretching the truth. Trucks carrying radioactive waste will be traveling through our neighborhoods, so no area is safe.
As for our track record, accidents will happen.
You're lucky.
Clean it up.
Nuclear waste. The problem is bigger than you think.
I dreamed all of the animals will be safe forever.
I dreamed our water got clean again.
I would like more trees to grow.
And the ozone layer will get strong again.
Fish are neat, and I don't want any of them to die.
I dreamed our Earth will get well again because everyone who lived here started doing things to help it.
Help our planet to get better.
Earth Day is April 22nd.
Heaton Kalan is the head of the South African Exchange Program on Environmental Justice. It's based in Jamaica Plains in Massachusetts. And speaking of the United States, that really was where you became aware of environmental injustice in your homeland. You worked for the National Toxics Campaign Fund, which was based in, well, it was based in Cambridge, wasn't it?
In Boston.
In Boston, Mass. And you, as part of working for this organization, were out in West Dallas, Texas. And suddenly out in West Dallas, Texas, you began to think about, well, environmental inequity in West Dallas, Texas, to the people of color in West Dallas, Texas, and then somehow connect it
right
to South Africa. Can you describe how that all kind of came together for you?
Yes, I've always been involved in anti-apartheid work. Never ever looked at South Africa through the environmental justice lens. I was asked to go to West Dallas, Texas to document the struggle there against the RSR lead smelter, and spent 3 days with the community folks there. Stayed in the community, ate with the community, talked to community members. And really, as I walked around looking at the rampant poverty, the people being affected, I started getting images of Southern Africa. And the main connection there were so many people with legs and arms and breasts amputated because of lead poisoning, that I started thinking specifically about Angola and Mozambique, where there's landmines, millions of unexploded landmines, and has resulted in hundreds of thousands of amputated people. So I started thinking of Southern Africa. And then I started thinking, what are the environmental justice implications in South Africa with all these corporations there, with the cheap source of labor, with mining, with imports and exports of hazardous waste? And that's when I started thinking about what that means for my country and environmental issues. So it was actually looking at South Africa through West Dallas that made me start thinking about environmental justice in South Africa.
Do you see a kind of a similarity in causality here between, well, the United States and South Africa? I mean, why it's happening there and why it's happening here?
I get that question all the time, all the time. People say, what are the links? Why South Africa? Why the US? And I have sort of thought about this quite a bit. And in general terms, there are three links that I draw between the US and South Africa. The first link is the most obvious one, as we've been talking about, is the connection between race, class, gender, and the environment. So how do these people get affected? The sort of levels at which people are getting affected and the formation of that paradigm, if you want to call it, is very similar. The second one is, we talked about Bantustans, the homelands, creation of pockets of land and using them as sources of labor and using them as dumping grounds. That parallel is very close to the whole system of Native American reservations in this country. Mm-hmm. So there's that connection. And with different companies putting nuclear waste rods in parts of New Mexico and using those as storage grounds for a lot of radioactive waste. So there's that parallel. The third parallel is, I think, becomes obvious once talked about, is the whole issue between military and environment. The military in the United States has been cited as America's worst environmental enemy. In the name of protecting people, it has actually polluted its people and its land. South Africa, the most militarized country on the continent, which people in the country and in the neighboring countries have actually faced the arsenal of the South African military, which has used Agent Orange, landmines, defoliants, biological chemical warfare in the area. What is the military's role with the environment? And they're the third or fourth largest landholders in the country, and they've polluted huge chunks of the South African landscape, just as the military is in the US. So I think that connection is very important, and we need to elaborate and talk more about militarization and environment.
I think, frankly, though, this is my reaction. The key commonality has to do with both societies being diverse and both societies having a heinous histories of racism. I mean, in the United States, we had apartheid for a couple of hundred years. I mean, that's what the Civil War was.
Exactly.
You know, all about changing, and then it's only begin to change somewhat in my lifetime. So it's kind of been interesting to me to see in the 1980s and 1990s, people in the U.S. pointing their finger, people in power at South Africa. I remember waking up on a Greyhound bus in 1959 in Texas, San Antonio, Texas, walking out to a bus stop where it was for colored people and one bathroom and white drinking. And I mean, this country has a long history of apartheid, and not just been in Texas. I mean, right. Up in New England, even indeed here where we're taping in Cambridge, Massachusetts, and in Boston, the record has not been very, very good in terms of racism. So I think that's probably the biggest link. The big question to me is, what do we all do about this? I mean, now, at least in the 1980s and 90s, we're aware about the nature of racism in both societies. Right. But how do we change it? I mean, just passing laws, just putting Nelson Mandela in charge, I don't know if that'll do it. I think maybe more systemic, more profound, more fundamental changes are necessary in South Africa, not to mention the U.S. Let's get back to that in a second on Enviro Close-Up.
Thank you. Don't worry. The safety valve is absolutely reliable. There is no need for concern. And anyway, once it's there, we might as well use it. Trust us.
To myself, what a wonderful world.
If you're not recycling, you're throwing it all away.
It's coming. The most significant event in automotive history. It's coming. The end of the age of the automobile.
Heat 10, how to end environmental injustice in South Africa.
That's a big task, but we need to really start grappling with the facts. The Reconstruction and Development Program, which is a program for the next 5 years for what the new government is going to implement to start reversing apartheid's legacy, has got a very strong tenet of sustainability in it. And I think that's very important that when we look at housing and providing 1 million houses in the next 5 years, we need to look at the environmental impact of that. What does it mean? Where's the sewage going to be drained into? What's the materials that these houses are going to be made out of? Do we want 1 million asbestos houses? We don't want that. What we need to do is have an environmental angle to every piece that we start looking forward to in South Africa. The big piece that I think is very important is that it's not South Africa specific. It's global. It's US. And it's very important that communities who are impacted get in touch with communities who are impacted, not only in the US, not only regionally, but internationally. And this is one of the things we're trying to do, is link up community groups here in the US with community groups in South Africa who come together and share ideas, strategies, histories, and their experiences with different corporations and different laws, different governments, be it state, federal, local. What works, what doesn't work. We need to get what I call building bridges or rebuilding old bridges and redefining what international solidarity really means. Because there's so much we as South Africans can learn from the grassroots groups here. And there's so much the grassroots groups here can learn from South Africans. We need to start sharing. Brought home to me it brought it clearest to me when I was in South Africa in about a year and a half ago, and there was a massive fire at Rhône-Poulenc, which is a French chemical company. And it affected a lot of people in the area, affected a lot of firefighters. And when I came back to the US, I read something about Rhône-Poulenc, an incident somewhere in the Midwest, I believe. And the incident was almost similar. Now, Rhône-Poulenc in the US and Rhône-Poulenc in South Africa talk to each other. These communities who are being affected aren't in touch with each other. And I think those communities need to know about each other, need to share with each other, and need to come together around these issues. The more we get community involvement, the more we're going to see the implementation of policy. You know, if the policy is just there, it doesn't help. But if communities know what the impact of that industry is on my health, on my children's health, then we can go and ensure that those policies are implemented. So I think what needs to be done is a massive awareness program. Farmers in South Africa who use extremely lethal pesticides, pesticides that are banned in the U.S., but imported from the U.S.
Right, sold for by U.S. That's manufacturers.
Right. Exactly. They sometimes, the farmers themselves are not aware of the danger of these pesticides because they bought by manufacturers in huge barrels and then repackaged in tiny packets. So there's no warning labels on them. And even if they are, we're assuming that farm workers are literate or understand English.
We'll be back with Enviro Close-Up right after this. Group's newest report on environmental injustice in South Africa. How can people get a hold of it? How can they connect with your organization and join in its good works?
Well, contact us and ask to be on our mailing list, and we can get this report available to people. And it will be a nice readable report for people to see, and it will elaborate on what we talked about today.
And you're located?
At 6 Goodrich Road, number 2, Jamaica Plain, Massachusetts, 02130.
And you clearly are looking and need help from all over the United States to help. Right. I mean, a lot of those big corporations in South Africa have been U.S. corporations causing this incredible mess. And I think it's very incumbent on all of us here in the U.S. to help undo some of the damage we helped cause. Thank you so much for being with us today on Enviro Close-Up. I'm Carl Grossman. And thank you for watching.